We turn then this morning to the account of the salvation of the Ethiopian eunuch. A fabulous story, well worth our attention and study. I've titled my sermon this morning, Another Sinner Saved. While our names might not be recorded in the Book of Life, in this book, they are in the Book of Life, while our lives might not be put down in history as an indication of God's grace at work, our salvation is very similar to what happened to this man. And in that we can be encouraged and instructed. What I have before you is a testimony, a witness account of something that actually happened and from which you and I can learn. I read of a man who gave his testimony in church, and he spoke at length about how God had loved him, called him, saved him, delivered him, cleansed him and healed him. And it was a very powerful testimony, but somebody afterwards says, "Oh, thank you for that, but you never told us about your part in being saved." So he thought for a minute, and this was his answer. "I apologize. I'm sorry. I really should have mentioned that my part was running away, and God's part was running after me until he found me." So many of us would say amen to that. We were busy on our own mad course through life when God in his grace and mercy brought the gospel into our presence. So how is this sinner saved? Let me go through my three subheadings. First of all, he's seeking. Secondly, he's sought. And thirdly, hallelujah, amen, he's saved. And if you want to add, he's baptized, isn't he? He's brought to that place of salvation and rest in Christ. I want to take a few minutes to begin with to consider the fact that this man is seeking. Now, it's important to see that this is a primary part of becoming a Christian. I'm not sure that he was entirely conscious that he was seeking, but clearly there are things going on in his life which are going to result in his salvation. Roy often quotes Jeremiah 29:13, "You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart." Now I want to lay that on our minds and hearts this morning. If a man or woman is ever going to be converted, they need to make it their business to get converted. Too many folks sort of sit and may think, well, there's going to be some kind of holy zap. Well, it's true, God does save some people very suddenly. But if you look at most of the folks here today, you will find that there has been a journey which they've been on. And with the benefit of hindsight, they will confess that, well, I was seeking. God was at work in my life. Important to recognize, the Bible says that for a man or woman to be seeking, God is at work in their life. Where would I get such an idea? Romans 3:11. "There is none who understands, there is none who seeks after God." That's the natural man, that's the unconverted person. That's the reason there are so many empty seats in so many churches today. People imagine they've got all that life contains for them. They understand what it's about, and they therefore can go their own way. God, well, if he does exist, I'll speak to him at the end of time. But the Bible is very clear that God begins his work in people's lives by giving them an itch, a hunger, a desire. And if you and I as Christians think for a moment, you would be able to say, yeah, that's true. There were events which led me to begin to think about God. My father died when I was 17. I joined the Merchant Navy when I was 19. And I still don't understand why, but I bought a New Testament and took it to sea with me. And I was reading it. I wasn't converted until 2 years later, but when I look back and sort of look at these connections, why? Because God was stirring my mind, stirring my heart, that I might be prepared to make the efforts to seek him. The scriptures are very clear. Psalm 110, verse 3. Your people shall be volunteers in the day of your power. When God comes by his power and his spirit and begins to work in our lives, the evidence, the first indication that he's working is a dissatisfaction with this world and all that it offers. A hungering for a relationship with God. A desire to do what's ever necessary to see that fulfilled. And I believe this Ethiopian is just a classic example. In the text we are told in verse 27, "And behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all her treasury and had come to Jerusalem to worship." Now I know it's just one verse in the Bible and it's quite possible just to say, okay, but I want you to put the brakes on. I want you to tarry here for a minute to take a long look at that text. He's a long way from home, isn't he? I did a quick check, probably it was Google Maps, but I used modern cities and I checked the distance from Jerusalem to Khartoum, because that's just about Ethiopia, where it was in those days. You know how far it was? 2.5 times the distance from Land's End to John Rhodes. You still don't know, do you? 1,600 miles. 1,600 miles. Oh, you say, it would be a long journey, but a good train, a good plane. You would go. No, no, let's go back to the first century. How did he travel? Well, we know he was going back in a chariot. And some of the books I read suggested that it wouldn't have been a sort of a warrior's chariot. It would be more like an ox car, a slow-moving. I wonder how long it took to get from Ethiopia to Jerusalem. I wonder, you see, just how much involvement this man. What would move a man to go from Ethiopia? That's, if you think in your mind, you've got the Mediterranean Sea, Egypt, and then underneath it is Ethiopia. In those days, it was the land of Nubia or Kush. And if somebody told you somebody came from Ethiopia, you would immediately assume that he was dark-skinned. He was an African. So here's this man leaving all of his culture and his world to go forth. It tells us here he was a eunuch. That means as a male he had been castrated, although there is some evidence that the term eunuch could be used just as a job title. But the normal mark of a eunuch was that this had happened and that he was therefore a servant of royalty, working in the royal court, and we're told here that he had worked up till he was the secretary of the treasury. He's an important man. Whether it was a chariot or an ox cart, it would be a posh one. But it still wouldn't have air springs and suspension. It would be a bumpy, bumpy journey. 1,600 miles, what, maybe 10 or 12 a day? Weeks, months of planning this man had gone under. He had come from what was an ancient kingdom. You know, sometimes when you're studying the Bible, it's very easy to go off into a bypath meadow. But what I found out yesterday was that this kingdom was formed when there was a dispute in Egypt and there was a split. And it was an alternative Egypt below Egypt. It was a very powerful nation in those days. We're told here that he was a servant of the queen. And she, of course, is called Candace in this passage. Again, a study of the books. Candace is a title, rather like Pharaoh. In Ethiopia, they believed that the male king was, in fact, an earthly representative of God. So his mother ruled in his place. So this guy is right up there. He's got everything his world could offer him. But he's moved to go to Jerusalem, 1,600 long miles. Why would he be moved to go to Jerusalem? He had come to worship. He had heard about the living God, and he had known about, probably at that time, all the events through Moses and Israel. We'll not rehearse the whole Old Testament. He had learned about all these things, and he had come to recognize that there was something special about Jerusalem. That God had a temple there. That God had manifested himself there in the days of Solomon. Interesting, now this is probably the same country that the Queen of Sheba came from when she visited Solomon. So he's seeking. That's what I need to establish. And nothing is going to get in his way. And what a time to be seeking that. We're in the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8. Just run your mind back through what's happened previously. Jesus of Nazareth has been in the city. He's been horrendously executed. He's been humiliated by being hung on a cross. And then he's alive again on the third day. The news had had a powerful effect on the city. There has been a revival of unprecedented extent. Not only these who are his followers are now talking about him, thousands of the citizens of the city have come to faith. I can't but help think that when this guy was in Jerusalem, he would be fully conversant. He's in royal circles. He'd be rubbing shoulders with the Roman rulers, the Sanhedrin, the Pharisees. And he wouldn't have missed a bit. He would have heard how Peter was told to stop preaching and couldn't be stopped. He would have learned about how that lame man who had been outside that temple begging for years was now skipping and dancing through the town. He would have heard about Ananias and Sapphira and the tragedy of their attempt to deceive God. There would be all kinds of things in his mind. The gospel would have been right at the forefront of his mind. But you know, when you study the Bible, one of the interesting things is that when he had gone to Jerusalem to go to the temple, because he's a eunuch, he can't go in. There's a verse way back in Deuteronomy 23, verse 1. He who is emasculated by crushing or mutilation shall not enter the assembly of the Lord. His heart wants God, but the Jewish law and rule says, you can't come in. You're excluded. Why would he go to Jerusalem? I think there's a clue in the fact that he's reading the book of Isaiah. We'll come back to the passage he's reading in a few minutes. But three chapters after the passage he's reading, there is in fact an incredible promise. This is what it says in Isaiah 56, verse 3. Do not let the son of the foreigner who has joined himself to the Lord speak, saying, the Lord has utterly separated me from his people. Now listen, nor let the eunuch say, here I am, a dry tree. For thus says the Lord to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths. In those days, that would have been one who wanted to be a proselyte. He's observing the law, you see. To the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths. And choose what pleases me, and hold fast my covenant, even to them I will give in my house and within my walls a place and a name better than that of sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. Now I'm somewhat persuaded that that eunuch, in being drawn to Judaism, confronted by this command which excluded him, I'm persuaded that somehow this verse had gotten to his mind. He's seeking because he knows that though in his own nature he's excluded, that in the promise of God and the purpose of God, there's a door open for him. And therefore he's prepared to cross land and sea, quite literally. Red Sea, remembers, and the road there somewhere. He's prepared to cross land and sea that he might find God. What an example. What a challenge to the day that I'm living in, when people are just so blasé and careless, and they imagine that if God exists, they'll sort him out when they meet him. people that have told me, I'll tell God. He'll understand. I was just about to say stupid fools, but it's not proper to call people stupid, is it? Madness. And that madness is seen in every individual who even goes to church and is not making it his or her business to get right with God. Unless you are actively pursuing him, you will never find him. Unless it's your business to get right with God, you'll stay in the dark and in the wrong. This man's serious. You see here, as Philip comes by, he was sitting in his chariot and reading Isaiah the prophet. Now again, the benefit of taking time to study, you know, when I say to you, sitting, reading Isaiah the prophet, I would guess that in your mind, you think of a Bible lying open. First century, no Bibles. What did they have? They had scrolls. And the scroll was 26 feet long, or a scroll of Isaiah was. If you ever see some of the pictures of the scriptures that were found in Qumran, the Dead Sea Scrolls, one of them was a cylinder of Isaiah, and it literally stood this high off the floor on two pins. So you rolled one and unrolled the other. And they cost a fortune. Because the Jews looked on their Old Testament as being the living Word of God. And they therefore treated it with great respect and reverence. I'm told that when it became worn out in Judaism, they had a formal burial service for the scroll. I'm telling you this because I want you to just get a picture of how serious this seeking is. He has dug deep into his pocket. Because he wants to read it for himself. Oh, what a privilege it is to be a Christian in the 21st century, or a seeker in the 21st century. You can go and get one of these books for less than £10. Isaiah included. Now I ask you, what are non-Christians doing? They're not paying any attention at all. And the great tragedy of my generation is that people are not in general seeking. God's judgment is upon us and he's leaving us to have what we want. And we need to cry out to God for the generation in which we live. If you remember, the Bible tells us that by nature we are dead in trespasses and sins. And if somebody finishes the race, as dead in trespasses and sins, they're separated from God forever. That's why I'm trying to argue these things before you this morning and ask you this very simple question. Are you seeking? Hebrews 11:6, without faith it's impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is. That's the first thing. You say, okay, I acknowledge God exists, but that's not what he says when it finishes. The verse goes on, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Make it their business. And one of the good things about this story is you see all of that teased out. Christian, thank God for the working of God in your life, whether it was dramatic or it took years. Thank God that he quickened your heart. He took out the stone and gave you one of flesh that had a hunger for him. And that hunger has been satisfied. Because you've come to Christ and you're at rest in him. You know you were just like the eunuch, excluded from God's presence, not by one command in the Old Testament, but by all of them. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Thank God that there are multitudinous, that's a big word, promises in the Word of God, which says that if you seek him, you will find him. When you seek him, how? with all your heart. That's fundamental. And if there's anybody who's listening to this recording or listening to my voice today and you're just curious and observing and thinking, oh well, you need to be alarmed. That's an indication of your final destiny. No God for you in this world, no God for you in the next. There isn't an escape route. Doesn't John Bunyan tell us that in Pilgrim's Progress? When one of the individuals gets to the pearly gates and the angel comes out and he's asked for his scroll and he doesn't have one, Bunyan just comments that right at that very eternal gate, there's a side door that leads all the way to hell. Tragic, isn't it, to spend your life going to church and not be passionate about the living God. Oh, dear friends, I thank God when I read passages like this. Because not only is this man seeking, he sought. Somebody's seeking him. The Saviour who came into the world to seek and to save that which was lost. How does he do it? Well, let's look at the narrative, because it's a lovely picture of how God works. God uses his word, and normally that includes people who bring it to you, and then the Holy Spirit takes the word brought by the people and uses it to bring you into the kingdom of God. And so we are told here that Philip, who was in the midst of a revival in Samaria, there was so much going on, I could almost hear Philip wanting to make the excuse, sorry Lord, I'm busy. But no, it says here, now an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, and arise and go toward the south along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is desert. Philip, I've got a job for you to do. I want you to speak to one individual. The rest, I'll take care of the rest. You go and speak to this one individual. I've been preparing him. He's seeking me, and now I want him to see that I'm seeking him. It's so important that this man hears the gospel explained to him, and that the Holy Spirit then would take that gospel and give him eternal life. So important. I don't think I can underestimate the importance of us as Christians being ready to be used. I'm sure you tremble at the thought of ever telling the gospel to anybody, but there will be times in your life when you are Philip. And only you are available to tell them about Christ. Check out the history of Philip in the book of John. He's a fascinating character. I'm biting my tongue because it'll take me a while to go down that road. But you go home and read about Philip in John's Gospel. It's his business all the time to be bringing people to Jesus. That's how he lives. That's what he lives for. Lord, let's go. And he's moved by an angel of the Lord. He's involved in a great work. Remember, Jesus says, you will be witnesses of me in Jerusalem and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. In those days, Ethiopia is the ends of the earth. It's the end of the civilized world, as most of them knew. And what we're watching then is the literal fulfillment of that command and promise of Christ. God takes the man. Go near and overtake this chariot, says the Holy Spirit. So the Philip ran to him and heard him reading the prophet of Isaiah. Apparently in ancient times, reading was not the common skill that we have. And therefore, when people read, they read aloud. So here's the Ethiopian. He's been to Jerusalem. He's got this promise from God. He's seen what's going on, and he needs to understand it. I'd like to think that he had read through chapter 1 to 52 before he got to 53. You know, it's on a big scroll. You can't just flick a page and open it here. So he's read all that God had said. The verse I quoted to poor Sophie again, to Zara this morning. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. A verse well worth learning if you're ever going to take the gospel to people. If you can't memorize it, know where to find it. Again, we could have a good morning just flicking pages in Isaiah. Page after page. You come to about chapter 40. Comfort you, my people. God is going to come like a royal king, John the Baptist going before him, making the road straight and flat. And God is going to come and fulfill the promises given to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And he's going to fulfill that by coming himself as the covenant. I like to think this dear man read all that stuff. The Holy Spirit, though, knows the limitations of our minds. He knows that there are people who are gifted to communicate, and again, that's hopefully what the preacher does. That they're able to pull together the bits of the Bible, go near and overtake this chariot. Again, somebody says, Philip must have been quite an athlete. But he doesn't have to be if this is an ox cart. He just has to get alongside and he'll be travelling at walking pace. But the command is, be glued to it. Get alongside him and get stuck in. Stick to him, even if there's some indication that he's not ready yet, stick with him. Be ready to be used, oh my dear beloved brothers and sisters, to realize that God not only causes men and women to seek, he prompts us to become his agents in directing them. I don't want to spend too much time with Philip, but again, when I began flicking my Bible, I kept on coming across verses which indicates that God uses people. Chapter 10, you'll find Peter being challenged about going to talk to Cornelius, and Cornelius being told that there's a man coming to explain things to him. I thank God for the men, the man. You know, I mentioned how I started seeking. I was a couple of years in the Merchant Navy and I'd read quite a lot by then. And I came home and I found, to my delight, my mother's youngest brother had been converted. He was a believer. So I came to Alec one day and I says, Alec, can I come to church with you? You know, in all my life, I've never had anybody ask me, can I come to church with you? And I thank God he was going to a godly church where the gospel was preached, and I came under the gospel in that church. You see, God used the man. He had prepared him. And as I asked my question, you could easily have said, no, it's just for folk like me. Let's be honest, dear beloved. If the gospel is to flourish again in our generation, us as Christians must be ready to confess our need of God to direct us to those who are in need of Christ, because God uses believers to pass on the good news. We don't have to be experts in translating it or explaining it. Learn a handful of verses. Get your ABCs. Romans 3. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's the place where you start. Then come to your B. But do you think I'm going with that one? Acts 16. What shall I do to be saved? The Philippian jailer said. And Paul's answer, Acts 16, 31, I think, or 30, 31. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. Romans 10, verse 9 is the letter C. If you will confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you shall be saved. It's as simple as A, B, C. And if you will just pack that into your mind and say, God, I've got it, take me to somebody who needs it. And be ready to stick at it, because in this generation they don't know they need it. And they might even want to avoid you because you want to tell them. But I thank God that there were men ready to speak to me. The minister of that church, John McKendrick, is singing with the angels now. I thank God that that man took time to explain Christ to me. Just like Philip did. And friend, if you're not a Christian and you're hearing this, you need to thank God for somebody trying with his stumbling, fumbling mouth to tell you it's time that you began to seek God and made it earnest and no longer just sat on the fence. Because you're going to fall off backwards. Finally, I want to get to this. I'm trying to, I've got a good 10 minutes left of my normal time. I want to get to this. He's saved. This is a marvelous story. There are just so many details. Again, you could do lots of sermons. What I want to do in this passage is just look at the questions and answers. Do you understand what you're reading? What a question to ask. You see somebody reading a Bible, don't ask them where they got it. Don't ask them what the chapter they're in. Just say, do you understand what you're reading? And if God's at work, you'll get an answer like Philip got. How can I? Unless someone guides me. Oh, God in heaven, I wish somebody would ask me that question today. How can I? Unless someone guides me. The questions in this passage are absolutely beautifully significant. Because when somebody asks a question like that, you know that God's at work. 1 Corinthians 2:14, the natural man, that's the unbeliever, and I hope it doesn't describe anybody here, does not receive the things of the Spirit of God. For they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. The unbeliever is distinguished by this. They don't care. Oh, they'll get religion. Religion's a part of life. You can't avoid it. But they're not really interested in a personal relationship with God through Christ. There's even a verse in Jeremiah which warns us about the state of the natural man, and it includes the Ethiopian. I'd forgotten this verse, Jeremiah 13:23. Can the Ethiopian change his skin, or a leopard its spots? And the answer, of course, is no. Can an Ethiopian change his skin? He can't do this for himself. There needs to be the supernatural work. He needs to come to the point where he claims Christ by faith. Do you understand what you're reading? How can I unless someone helps me? You need real wisdom and grace to get alongside somebody and explain to them that they're a sinner. I remember in the marketplace one year, a lady from Whitby, we were having a really serious conversation. And she said to me, no, she says, we need to stop, you're getting far too personal. Far too personal. When you get to the nerve, there's a choice to be made, isn't there? To actually say, like the mirror, God's word has shown me that it's not the blemish of my face that mars, it's the blackness of my heart. And it needs to be fixed. Poor Roy had some kind of a heart incident, was it 10 days ago? And they whisked him to hospital the same day. There was no heart. I was impressed. I hope I never have a heart attack, but I've got some assurance that I'll get good attention. You need a heart attack today if you're not a Christian. You need the urgency of knowing that you need help. Oh, Lord, what a generation I live in. Many of our own children, blasé about the gospel. If that doesn't get you praying, you've never understood prayer. Let me go on though. I ask of you, says the man, whom does the prophet say this of himself or of some other man? He's reading Isaiah 53, which is one of the most clear descriptions of the gospel in the Old Testament. But it speaks about the fact that there's a sheep being led to the slaughter, a lamb who before his shearers is dumb. You remember when Jesus was being questioned, he didn't answer them at all. You remember how the Lord Jesus is described as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world? When you're a Christian, you see these all linked together, but this man's not in Christ yet. It's still a dark tunnel to him. So he needs the kind of insight that Jesus gave to the disciples on the road to Emmaus. He needs somebody to go through the Old Testament and say, see, that's Jesus. See, this is Jesus. See, Jesus is the only way that you can ever have a living relationship with God, because you deserve judgment. But he's taken it in your place. Every day, morning and evening, a lamb was sacrificed in the Jewish temple. And when it came to the feast days, the rivers flowing through the city turned red. Because these innocent creatures were being put in as substitutes. The people deserve God's judgment, the animals get it. That's the picture of Jesus. That's Isaiah 60:53. In his humiliation, his justice was taken away. If you find slight differences here from the text of Isaiah 53, it's because generally what's been done here is they're quoting the Greek version of the Old Testament called the Septuagint. It's very minor differences, none of them of any significance. But what it wants us to understand is that Jesus was not treated fairly. Even Pilate acknowledges he's innocent but agrees to have him executed. It's all here. For his life is taken from the earth. It quite clearly has a powerful effect upon the Ethiopian. It quite clearly transforms his life. They come to some water. They're in the desert, remember. Water's rare. Providence of God, there are a couple of places, if you check any of the books that study these things, there are a couple of places. There's one where there's a deep stream and another where there's a pool along this well-known road. He comes to water and he sees the water, and you know, you get this indication that God has done a work. Let me just go back. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What hinders from me from being baptized? That would indicate to me that in Philip's explanation of what Jesus did through Isaiah 53, he's also went on to say that the gospel calls us to believe and be baptized. He would have seen the baptisms of the thousands in Jerusalem. He would know that baptism is the way that you make a public declaration, I belong to Christ. I have died with him. I'm rising to live a different kind of life. The baptism itself doesn't save. Notice how the text actually helps us understand this. Philip doesn't say, oh good, you want to be baptized, let's dunk you. The text says, if you believe with all your heart, that's the criterion, dear friend. And the man answers, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That's the testimony. The Son of God who loved me, gave himself for me, and now I want everybody to know that I'm his. I long for the first baptismal service we have in here. I don't know whether we'll use a portable baptistry or whether we'll dig a hole in the floor and put one in, but I long for the problem. That's right. And I'll have a big banner outside to let them know it's happening. And I'm praying that God's going to give us some soon. I'm praying that God's going to set somebody's heart on fire, make them hungry for God so that they begin to seek. And I'm longing that either you, me, or somebody else associated with us is like Philip, ready to be alongside. All the glory belongs to him. It doesn't matter which one of us is involved. What does matter is they come to faith in Christ. So he commanded the chariot to stand still, and both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water. That tells us how deep it was. This is not a puddle. And he baptized him. The word baptize means to dip, to plunge, to immerse. King James didn't like that translation, so he told the people who wrote the Bible at the time to do what's called transliterate, just to put the Greek letters into English letters, and so he created a new word called baptism. Baptized him. Now when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord, that's an incredible truth too. Here's this Ethiopian, he's just come to faith in Christ, he's just been baptized, and he's away back to Ethiopia. There's a long history of real Christianity in that part of the world from the earliest times. This man went home on fire for God. See what God has done for me. If you seek him, you will find him. If you find him, you want to be baptized, you want to be set apart. My time's gone. Do you expect any of that to happen in Middleton Chapel? I'm rebuked. May God show us mercy and brings us new days of the power of his Spirit saving, converting, and resulting in baptisms. Amen.